Let's pray. Let's close our eyes and bow our heads in prayer. Father God, we want to come to you today, Father, and we want to thank you. We want to thank you for this time that you've given us to come to your presence, Lord, to listen to your word, to understand, to grow, to learn about you even more, Lord. We want to thank you, Lord Jesus, for the powerful, inspiring messages that Dr. George Shandy has placed before us these last 3 days. We want to pray, Lord, that you will be with him and bless him in his ministry at Believers Hospital, Lord, in Thiruvella. And in all that he does, you'll be with him and with his family, and you'll bless him, Lord. Lord Jesus, we pray for all of us that we listen to your word, Lord, through him, Lord. As the busyness of the day is done, and as in these moments of quietness and stillness, Lord, during these next few minutes, that we'll just hear your word. We'll grow closer to you. We'll become more like you. We especially pray, Lord Jesus, that we will be able to calm our voices within us, calm the voices around us, that we will only hear your one and true voice, Lord, and that this period will be a fulfilling time to draw to you, to look on you as our source of inspiration, to look on you as our source of wisdom, to realize that everything comes only from you, Lord Jesus, and may we give back to you in the lives that we lead. And may we learn to be more like you. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen. Amen. The scripture reading for today is taken from John chapter 20, verse 1 to 18. John chapter 20, verse 1 to 18, the empty tomb. Early on the first day of the week, while it was still dark, Mary Magdalene went to the tomb and saw that the stone had been removed from the entrance. So she came running to Simon Peter and the other disciple, the one Jesus loved, and said, "They have taken the Lord out of the tomb, and we don't know where they have put him." So Peter and the other disciple started for the tomb. Both were running, but the other disciple outran Peter and reached the tomb first. He bent over and looked in at the strips of linen lying there, but did not go in. Then Simon Peter came along behind him and went straight into the tomb. He saw the strips of linen lying there, as well as the cloth that had been wrapped around Jesus' head. The cloth was still lying in its place, separate from the linen. Finally, the other disciple who had reached the tomb first also went inside. He saw and believed. They still did not understand from scripture that Jesus had to rise from the dead. Then the disciples went back to where they were staying. Now Mary stood outside the tomb crying. As she wept, she bent over to look into the tomb and saw two angels in white seated where Jesus' body had been, one at the head and the other at the foot. They asked her, "Woman, why are you crying?" "They have taken my Lord away," she said, "and I don't know where they have put him." At this, she turned around and saw Jesus standing there, but she did not realize it was Jesus. He asked her, "Woman, why are you crying? Who is it you are looking for?" Thinking he was the gardener, she said, "Sir, if you have carried him away, tell me where you have put him and I will get him." Jesus said to her, "Mary." She turned towards him and cried out in Arabic, "Rabboni," which means teacher. Jesus said, "Do not hold on to me, for I have not yet ascended to the Father. Go instead to my brothers and tell them, I am ascending to my Father and your Father, to my God and your God." Mary Magdalene went to the disciples with the news, "I have seen the Lord." And she told them that he had said these things to her. Here ends the Bible reading.
You know, 28 years back, this was the first song that Joshua actually did with us, with Glorious, the first time, actually, 28 years back. "Tell everyone that I love them. I want you all to come." We have been listening to Dr. George Shandy Matitra for the last 3 days. Today is his fourth day. And he has been leading us through a journey of standing with Jesus, choosing to stand with Jesus, or to stand with this desperately lost world. And how It is so necessary to awaken the love in our hearts to reach out to the lowly and the needy. Where are we? Are we there at the cross? Are we there with the risen Savior? Dr. George Chandy was the director of CMC Wellow. Presently, he is the director of Believers Medical College and Hospital, Tiruvalla. He has been a great encourager to very many people, a humble, gentle, patient, quiet person. I should know because I am his younger brother. And he has been a, you know, the, he is the carnivore of our family now. So we are all excited for the fact that he has been with us these last 3 days. Today is his last day with the fourth chapter of what Dr. George Chandy would like to tell us. Dr. George Chandy.
Thank you, Mohan. Thank you, Reggie. Yes, for journey we've had over the last 23, 24 days. Thank you for all that shared, and also for my journey with you in preparing for this, because I've learned a lot in preparing. Just to recap, on day one, we heard the story that was written in the book called His Name, which reminds us that not only has the Lord saved us, but God in His mercy has handed over the stewardship of this world to us. And then came that child singing that song, asking the question, especially with the happenings in Ukraine in the background, why does it have to be like this? So we reflected on how we were totally moving away from the way God had planned it for us. And then we took up a very difficult word from the book of Isaiah, chapter 53 and verse 3. He was despised and rejected by men. He was despised and we esteemed him not. So we reflected on the rejection that Jesus suffered. And he being our role model, we looked at how he responded to the Pharisees, to the disciples who betrayed him, denied him. And then we wondered what our response should be when people reject us. And I realized at that time, the first time somebody says something that hurts me, I tend to react. On day three, we reflected on how Jesus was despised. Now, this is the God who has created us, created the world, and has sent Jesus to be with us, to save us. And our response is to despise him, hate him, loathe him. He was mocked by the guards, beaten up, blindfolded, and said, prophesy if you are the God, if you are the king. And then all the subversion that goes on. And then we looked at St. Matthew's Gospel, chapter 5 and verses 10 and 11, where we are told, blessed are we when we are persecuted for righteousness. So today, on day four, Reggie had told me that you must divide up this sermon into four parts, and then part four should be on day four. And I was going to reflect on the man of sorrows. And I realized 3 days I have discussed with you some very, very difficult problems. Can we look at something a little easier? And I thought I'd look at something that the glorious has been so good at, being with people, supporting people, encouraging people, psychologically helping people, with the spirit encouraging people. And I know of several people who have received new life because of their ministry. And so I did something that Reggie didn't do. He played only the first two verses of Where You There. And this was a popular song at home. My father, our father used to sing it so often. And so we have this verse four, which says, Were you there when he rose from the dead. And then we say, but we trembled. So even when he rose from the dead, we trembled. Shall we pray? Father God, it's so wonderful to know that at the end of all this, there is still hope because of your grace, because of your love. And as we heard in that song, because you reach out to us, continue to reach out to us. Speak to us today, O Lord, we pray in Christ Jesus' name. Amen. Max Lucado is my favorite author, and I'm sure he's yours as well. And he writes a beautiful story about his visit to South America, to Brazil. And he was with friends and who took him to a funeral. And here is this parlor, funeral parlor. Somebody had passed away, a lady. And there was the usual homilies, talks. But after everybody left, there was one lady, very well clad, a tall young lady, standing by, and tears were rolling down her eyes. And even as everybody left, Max Lucado could hear her say, "Obrigada, obrigada." It was just a series of obrigadas. Obrigada in Brazilian means thank you. So he went up to her and had a word with her and realized that this young, smart lady was an orphan. She had nobody. And this lady who had died in an accident had picked her up from the road, taken care of her, given her new life, made her feel that she was her daughter. And today, when she was someone in society, looked up to, all she could say was thank you. And even as I read that story, I wondered, shouldn't we be saying thank you all the time? Shouldn't we be saying obrigada all the time for the life that has been given to us, for the love with which God has taken care of us, for all that has been given and all that lies ahead of us? And I want to reflect with you on the lives of two people who, like this young lady, stayed with Jesus throughout. St. Luke's Gospel, chapter 1, verses 26 to 38. We read how Mary knows that she is going to give birth to the Lord himself. And as she is told this, she is shocked, but then she says, "I am the Lord's servant. May it be as you have said." And then from verses 46 to 56, we hear that beautiful song, which is called the Magnificat, where she praises God. St. Matthew's Gospel, chapter 1, verses 18 and 19, the virgin will be with child by the Holy Spirit. St. Luke's Gospel, chapter 2 and verse 7, there was no room for them in the inn. There was no room for Mary to give birth to her child, and therefore she has to lay her child in the manger. St. Luke's Gospel again, chapter 2, verses 35 to 39, we read about Simeon and Anna, all that they had to say. And she keeps all that in her heart, wondering what is going to happen, but yet trusting, because the angels had been sent to tell her the good news. In St. Luke's Gospel, chapter 2, verses 48 and 49, we read that time in the temple. And in verse 51, it says that she treasured all these things in her heart. But then later in St. Mark's Gospel, chapter 3, verses 31 to 34, we read that Jesus is in the midst of a large number of people. And just then, Mary, his mother, and brothers come to meet him. And somebody goes and tells him that, and he says, who are my mother and my brothers, all of you who listen to the word of God. So there have been times like this, which must have hurt Mother Mary. But then in St. John's Gospel, chapter 19 and verse 25, we read that near the cross stood his mother, and he hands her over to his favorite disciple, who is St. John. So through life, through all the difficulties, Mother Mary stays with him, sometimes far away, sometimes not sure what's going to happen, but still she sticks with him till the very end, even as she sees her son being crucified and dying, she is near the cross. The other person that I want to talk to you about is Mary Magdalene. St. Luke's Gospel, chapter 8 and verse 1 and 2, we read that 7 demons were taken out of her. Maurice Casey, the author of Jesus of Nazareth, he says that she was a Jew from Magdala, which is on the western shore of the Sea of Galilee. She probably had a very bad physical ailment and a psychological problem, because she was battered and bruised, and she was looking for to be exorcised. And here is Jesus curing her, making her completely well. And for her, Jesus had given her life all over again. That was enough. She wasn't looking for another life. She was looking to follow the person, the man, who gave her that new life. So in the Bible, she is mentioned 12 times as a person who followed Jesus. She was amongst the women who were watching from a distance. In Mark's Gospel, chapter 15 and verse 40, St. Luke's Gospel, chapter 23, verse 49, women were watching from a distance, even as the men were away, probably because it was safer for them, probably because they didn't want to leave their Lord. Mary Magdalene was one of them. And in St. Matthew's Gospel, chapter 27 and verse 61, we read that she was sitting opposite to the tomb, even as Joseph of Arimathea laid Jesus in the tomb. St. Luke's Gospel 23 and verse 55, we read that she followed Joseph, would not leave Jesus, even though she knew that he was dead. And that is what made it easy for her to find the tomb on Sunday morning when she went looking with the spices. So I want you to look with me at this verse, which is so crucial. St. John's Gospel, chapter 20 and verse 14. We know that she came on Easter morning and found that the tomb was open. She's spoken to by the angel saying that he is risen. But she still doesn't go. She still waits there. And then she hears a voice from behind. And she thinks that that's the gardener. She turned around and did not realize that it was Jesus. She turned around and did not realize that it was Jesus. This is something very important for us to realize during this Lenten season. That Mary Magdalene, who followed Jesus all those years and was totally committed to him, he is there appearing to her as the first person after his resurrection. And she doesn't recognize him, doesn't realize that it was Jesus. And I want to suggest 3 reasons why she did not recognize or realize that it was Jesus. First was because she did not expect it. She had seen Jesus dead and buried in the tomb. So anyone else speaking could sound like him, but it could not be Jesus. So first of all, she did not expect to see or meet a risen Jesus. Secondly, I think she was in a lot of trouble. She was still sorrowing because of the death of her Lord. Her eyes were blurred. Her hearing was inadequate. All those reasons put together, she did not realize that it was Jesus. And thirdly, and most importantly, she did not know scripture. She did not know, or she did not remember, that Jesus would rise again and that he would be there with them. My dear friends, this is something that can afflict all of us. That even as God promises us a fantastic future, maybe we do not expect it. Maybe we are sorrowful because of the problems that are happening all around. And our eyes are blurred. And maybe we don't know scripture well enough. Because when Jesus called Mary by name, she recognized him. And she responds in Aramaic, Rabboni, which means master. And then she's able to go rushing back to tell the world, I have seen the Lord. I have seen the Lord. What does this tell us today? What should be our response during this Lenten season? Even as we reflect on how God in all his mercy sent his son to save us, but he was despised, he was rejected, he was a man of sorrows. But those who stayed with him, we have two examples here, his own mother and Mary Magdalene, who get to rejoice with him. There's a story that Philip Yancey has written in his book, What is So Amazing About Grace. It's about a girl who at the age of 12 left home in Orange City. She wanted to see what the world had to offer. She went looking for the good things in life. Her parents had no idea where she was. The first year went well. She had lots of fun, lots of people wanting her. But as the years went by, 2-3 years, she was no longer wanted. She was on the streets of New York. And she reached a stage where she decided that she has to end her life. But just before that, she said, let me just try once. She gives a call and leaves a message on the phone for her parents, saying that I'm coming by such and such a bus on such and such a day. I know you hate me. I know that you wouldn't call me back, want me back. But even as the bus comes to Orange City, such and such a bus stop, if you are there, I will get off. If not, I will carry on to I don't know what. So even as the bus was approaching Orange City, this girl wondered, what a foolish decision I've made. What if my parents are traveling? What if they don't hear my message? What will happen? But the story goes on to say that even as she reached the Orange City bus stand, from a distance she could see lights everywhere. She could see balloons everywhere. That bus station was full of people, all welcoming this prodigal girl back from a life wherein she had destroyed herself. And the story goes on to say that with this welcome, life changed totally for her. And because of what she had received, she stood for the Lord all her life, fought her way whenever there was trouble, and she glorified God's name in everything she did. Aren't we in a similar situation? Aren't we children who went astray? And yet God, in all his mercy, gave us His son to be despised, to be rejected as a man of sorrows, to be crucified for us, suffer and die for us. But he rose again. So the victory is ours. And so during this Lenten season, help us, may God help us, like the two Marys, to stay with him, to stay with his people, so that in so doing, we might receive the blessings and a life ever after.
Let's pray. Father God, we want to thank you for this lovely time, Lord, this time of listening to your word, of growing, Lord Jesus, through this journey. Yes, Lord Jesus, you were rejected, you were despised, but you're the God of hope, as brought out so powerfully and beautifully by your servant, Lord Jesus, today, Dr. George Chandy. And we want to thank you for that, Lord. We want to thank you that, yes, Lord Jesus, we are often like, and sometimes unlike Mary and Mary Magdalene, as well as the mother of Mary. We don't follow you around sometimes. And it's really true, like the nursery rhyme, you know, Mary had a little lamb. Lord, teach us to be that little lamb, to follow you around wherever you walk, wherever you go. That's what your mother did. Your mother followed you. Your mother treasured these things. Mary Magdalene walked, she knew, and then she ran. And it's so joyous, Lord Jesus, to actually have that good news that I have seen the Lord. Father God, teach us to see you. Teach us to thank you. Not just thank you for the cross, but thank you for everything. From the start of our life to the end, you have begun a good work in each and every one of us. And we want to thank you, Lord Jesus, for that. Father, we want to thank you for how you've been to us. But teach us, Lord, to not have blurred vision, to not get lost in our own expectations or problems or difficulties, that we can't see you. Teach us to look like Mary, teach us to look, because you promise us that, Lord Jesus, in Jeremiah 29, that if you seek me with all your heart, you will find me. Teach us to find you, Lord Jesus. And teach us to find you because we seek you. But sometimes when we don't know that we found you, exactly what you did for Mary, Lord Jesus, do that. Call us by name, because you are that good shepherd and you know every sheep and you call every sheep by name. And it's so lovely to know that we are called by you. Sometimes we need that extra voice. It sounds sad. It sounds not very nice. But it's true, Lord. We don't realize. Teach us to memorize your word so that we do realize. And also give us that extra voice, Lord Jesus, that extra time. Teach us to hear you in every breath, Lord Jesus, Yahweh, Lord Jesus, that first breath, Father God. Teach us to hear you in every breath, in everything that we do, whether it's in the work, whether it's in the play, whether it's while we eat our food, whether it's while we rest. Teach us, Lord Jesus, to just depend on you, to rely on you, and to grow, to listen only to you, and help us follow you wherever you go. Father, as a shepherd, lead us, and may we always stay true to you. Thank you again for Reggie Uncle and this Cyril and Kavya and this lovely time, and especially for Dr. George Chandy for bringing us this message. We commit all of us also and all our needs into your mighty hands. You know all of us and what we are going through. We commit all of that also into your mighty hands. Lord Jesus, we pray for a good night's rest as well. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Priya, for leading us in prayer. Thank you, Chelsea, for handling the back end today. Thank you for all the people who are here this evening. Thank you, Ajay, Dr. George Chandy, for this wonderful time that you gave us these last 4 days. So much to think about. So much to recognize as to how much we really need to remember that we tremble. This song especially, the major part of this song is, I tremble when I remember where I am, where I should have been, where I could have been. Thank you for the thoughts that you put us through, for the different aspects that you laid out before us. I'm sure that we will be blessed just looking at it from this perspective. A couple of announcements. Those of you who have not joined the prayer group, the WhatsApp group, you can just use the link that is there in the chat box and you can join us. We are going to try and post all the songs that we have been playing. People have been asking about where to find those songs and what the names are. So tomorrow onwards, we'll try and post the songs. We'll have the link in the chat box as to how to join the group for those of you who have not. And also, we also have the link for Glorious Talks, our YouTube channel, where you can visit and actually see all our earlier talks, the meditations for Lent, as well as our earlier Monday morning talks, as well as the Fruits of the Spirit talks that we have had before that. Tomorrow we have another ex-director. He's the ex-director of Baptist Hospital. His name is now Dr. Naveen Thomas. The next 4 days, Dr. Naveen will be ministering to us. So do join in at 9 o'clock. Because we'd like to be in the corporate room in prayer for some more minutes, please do that. Otherwise, we'll meet tomorrow at 9 o'clock sharp. Thank you for being with us. May God be with us and give us a good time for the rest of this Lenten. Thank you. God bless you.